I'm super excited to finally have Susan Aparicio join our class. I met Susan first when we were both at UVA in Charlottesville, Virginia. You were in your extended, like the extra year, right? What do
Yeah.
they call that year over there? I
The
forgot.
fifth year
Fifth year.
fellowship. Yeah, fifth
Nice.
year.
Oh, and it's a fellowship. Does that mean tuition was covered?
Well, it's not like I'm in, it's like post grad, so it's like they give you a stipend and then a studio space. But
Oh,
I
right, the
nowhere to
studio
live.
space.
But yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, we get a little studio.
That's awesome. And then after that, you went to UCLA for grad school, right? And then now that's where you are now. You're based in Los Angeles.
Yes. Yeah. So I'm still here. I graduated 2022.
Nice. Yeah, when I first met you, you were doing digital work, and I was very excited. You're doing like lots of screens, some interactive digital work, very much like visual, or maybe like in the throughput of like photo to video, lots of lens-based stuff. And then sort of at the end of our sort of interaction, you suddenly jumped into stained glass. I want to hear you talk about like how that started, but I remember being sort of shocked, like, what is going on? Like, you are a tech artist. What is this stained glass business? And then since
Yeah.
then, watching you incorporate those two things together has kind of blown my mind, and sort of shown me that I could be really artistically closed-minded. And so that I'm a huge fan of your work. Thank you so much for joining us today. And I'm going to be taking notes, so if you see me like looking down, I'm just taking notes. But please, everyone, we're going to have like 15 minutes for questions at the end. So if you have any questions for Susan about really anything, like from living in Los Angeles or being a professional artist, or like a process that you use in your artwork, please don't be shy. Okay, cool. I'm going to turn it over to you, Susan. Thank you again.
All right, I can't see anyone, so I'm just gonna go with it until I hear an interruption. So my name is Susan Aparicio. Like Dana said, we met at UVA. I am a multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary visual artist. So I kind of like, I mix it up sometimes, so sometimes I stay in one lane for a while, and then I kind of get bored and mix it up again between these mediums, mainly glass and video right now. But I get bored very easily, and I'm more like idea centric, so I kind of follow the idea, and I've been doing that more recently, like more conceptually thinking about like what medium I'm using for my practice. So we'll see a little bit of a mix today. I am Mexican, Honduran American. I am based in LA. I also grew up here in LA, so I'm working kind of very close to home now. And my work right now centers around themes of pop culture, about worship, mainly coming from that stained glass perspective, the internet, and general existential thoughts that I have. So when I entered photo, I did film photography. I started first at UVA. I don't know if you know this, Dana, but in math, and I also got a degree in cognitive science,
Are you
which
serious?
is,
I had no
yeah.
idea. That's amazing.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So I'm not like, I didn't come in as an artist. I'm really, really bad at drawing. So I really was attracted to the digital arts because I'm not creative in that way by hand. So yeah, I kind of came in doing a lot of computer science as well when I started art in my kind of third year. And I started with pulling from existing photos a lot and playing with collage and like digital photography. So I have a hard drive that's really full and I constantly have to increase terabytes because I like to digitally store everything. So my process is just like playing with kind of found footage or things I already have. So like for this example process, one of the last things I made in Virginia was a collage series based on these family photos. So, this is an example of my hard drive is like I have a selection of photos. I pick a photo that's really interesting to me. I cut it out. And then I kind of have created this folder that just has a bunch of cropped people in it. And then I, yeah.
Oh, wow.
So, it's
Oh,
kind of
this is
like all this
incredible.
content. Yeah, so I'm kind of generating like all these figures and people. I also know like Maya, which is like a 3D modeling software that I learned at UVA as well. And I started like making objects. I made couches. I also made like there's folders of desks and drawers, food, coffee. So then I would pull from these and just like have all these feeds of content and all these files. So then I would just put them together and take out that crop baby at first and then create my own background for it. So at UVA, I took all these kind of digital skills together just for in this more collage method. And I made a big series of these. And I also moved from that photo into video. So I was doing the same kind of thing where I was taking the backgrounds out with green screen, and instead I was putting myself in there in like a video format and filming. And I made these series of videos, which I think I made like a together they're like 1 to 2 minutes, 1 to 3 minutes, but altogether I think I made like 30 minutes of footage that I compiled. And it's based on English language learning videos that I used when I was kind of trying to understand like the very traditional like white American way of speaking in Virginia. Since I was from LA, and I'm Mexican Honduran, I was just in a huge culture shock. So it was like a way to kind of play with the culture in Virginia, like the white culture that I was surrounded by, and trying to understand it. And it actually did help. Like after that, I kind of looked back at these videos and I'm like, oh, okay, this way of talking is like this cultural aspect and like learning English and learning the culture. So I'll play a quick video, just like 2 minutes. It's called Planning a Trip.
Planning a trip.
Does everyone know what they want to do on our trip to Florida?
Well, Kathy and I want to go shopping every day.
And David and I want to go boating and fishing every day.
And Tina and I want to go to the beach every day.
And the zoo. And the museum, and the mall.
Wait. I think we have too much to do in 1 week.
David is right. We should make a schedule of everything that we would like to do each day.
Okay. I have a pen and paper. I'll write down everything we plan to do.
Okay.
Okay, on Sunday, we'll go to the airport and fly to Florida. We'll arrive at the hotel in the evening.
And on Monday, can we all go to the beach together?
Sounds good. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Tuesday, everyone can go shopping together, and we'll buy gifts and souvenirs.
On Wednesday, the men can go boating and fishing, the women can go shopping again, and the kids can go to the beach again.
And Thursday, we can go to the zoo.
Friday, the women and children could go to the amusement park, and the men could go boating and fishing again.
I think Saturday should be a day for everyone to do what they want to do, just a free day.
And of course, on Sunday, we go to the airport and we fly home.
Well, I think we have a good plan for our trip to Florida.
Yes, I've written down our plans for Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and the last Sunday. I'm so excited!
Okay, that was that. This is also like what I applied to grad school with, and it's something that they like a lot of schools really liked, apparently. I didn't really know what I was doing. So I'm happy with them. When I went to UCLA, I started in 2019, and it was very different than UVA. UCLA as a school is very different than UVA. There was like some like figuring out like my practice there and a lot of changing, trying out different ideas and working with new faculty. So it was different. I played a lot with how to shoot my backgrounds and my videos. They were very anti-green screen. Like they just thought it was really outdated and like not much to play with there. So they really pushed me to shoot in different ways with different environments and different things practically. So in some videos, I'll show examples. Like, this was a video where I had a projector and I had like objects and I was holding a screen that played other videos on it. I did like a monologue. This was a video where I did a monologue and it was, I was filming in front of a TV. So there was a video of clouds moving in the back. So just to show that it is moving, it's a real TV. It was just like really big and I was in front of it. And kind of with the lighting, just like to make it look a little bit more flat, but not green screen. So it doesn't have that green screen look. And then I would project things, like I project my face onto different objects as a way to create imagery as in collage, but like a kind of more real time or practical, like in-person video collage. So I have like my photo in a frame and I have my photo or like a video playing on this doll. And I have my hands kind of like brushing your hair. And then in 2020, it was COVID lockdown in LA. And it was very, it was just intense. Everything went online for that point of time in my grad school experience. So it kind of was like became a very heavy time to just play with video. So I practiced shooting in different areas of my apartment. So this is a video where this portion was like a Zoom meeting. So I shot in my living room, my kitchen, a dining area, and then a different part of my living room. So just playing with different backgrounds and like my styling for how I'm going to look, like my characters. And I also started to play with my own characters and my own voice and kind of trying to figure out my character versus the characters that I was kind of just going on to at UVA. So it was a lot of experimentation. This was a different video where like I was eating soup in the projector, and then there was like my husband Peter plays the oboe, so I had him play something for me. It was very like experimental. A video where I had kind of collage elements, and then it was COVID still, so it was 2020, and I'm like,
this looks trying amazing, to be in characters.
Yeah, it's hard. There's like I can't show all these videos, but it was just also about playing with these characters and backgrounds. And I did a lot of monologues at this time because I was writing and kind of figure out like what my characters are wanting to say. This one was kind of just playing with family photos as like these cherished objects. So they're like in these vases and playing with green liquid as a green screen. So kind of playing with that again. And then this is a video that was kind of like, I'll show this clip from those videos, a selection. It's called Some Paul and Some Britney, etc. And the Paul is referring to Paul McCarthy, who is a video artist and someone that was referenced a lot when thinking of my work. So let me play this one. I'm just going to play a clip. The whole video is about like, let's see. It's hard with this thing here. Okay. The whole thing's about like 7 minutes, and it's different segments of videos.
People tell me I have your temper. People tell me I have your laugh. I have your skin. You are the shouts in my dreams. I am ruined by blood type. You have given your blood to me without knowing of its acceptance. Now what's inside of you is inside of me. Killing me. Me! Thank you. You flow within me, circulating. There is no second opportunity. This is all one.
So that was also playing with, it's still the Zoom COVID time. So it was like shooting with my car in like the garage and then shooting like in my bedroom with that like piñata scene. And Paul McCarthy, my grandparents both passed away and he became like this grandparent figure at UCLA of like the new genres video program there. And everyone just kept referring to him over and over again. And it made me really tired because he's like, I like his work, but it's just weird when it's like this older white man and I'm like, I don't know him. And everyone keeps talking about how he's so important to me. So I was experimenting with like different performance and writing at that time. Okay. And then the next year I focused kind of on, again, in video and playing with it, but it was going through a lot of family footage. My dad, he like brought out these tapes that were like the home video tapes, and I digitized all of them, and there was about 60, and so I could have them as actual digital files and not just like in a box of tapes that are like gonna deteriorate. So I digitized them all, and I went through the process of looking through all of them. So it's like a lot of footage. And it's a lot of also like learning about family. So it was kind of a process, and we were still not in person. So I just also had a lot of time to go through these. And I would go through them. I would play with, if I thought a clip was interesting, I'd play with it. Again, like collaging like a photo of myself with like a still from a video and a lot of layering. And I really found that I love the layering and editing process of video and trying to make meaning of all these videos together. I also found in these tapes that my dad had been in the 2000s and like the 90s a like UFO chaser, or he would like on his own. So he would like document in the videos sometimes, like intermixed with our family, like birthdays would be like him narrating about like chasing aliens and like finding it and like his happenings with aliens. And it would just be always on his mind, and he would document his thoughts on it. And his shooting the moon over and over, or things he saw in the sky. So I, going through all the footage, slowly realized this kind of storyline and put it together with my own footage of myself and photos of myself and collaging and layering everything together. These are some stills, also going through family footage and like the joy of that time with my family when everyone was also really young. That's me as a kid. And I'm gonna play a clip from this too. It's called In Search of Aliens, which is the title that he gave his videos. I'll just play this clip. It's kind of in the middle of the video. It's 11 minutes.
Pues aquí voy rumbo a Los Monches, aquí por la carretera de Arizona, Freeway 10. Y pues aquí todo calmado, muy plano la carretera. Estoy viendo aquella área de allá. Allá es donde aterrizan los ovnis. Allá andan en el loma que ella te permite. eso voy alerta, voy grabando para ver si veo uno.
En otra estilo.
Suck.
Why do you believe in aliens?
I like to believe in them because it's just different than humans. Because when you really think about it, you really think humans are the only like beings out here. Like in like this whole like solar system, like the universe, the billions of universes that are out here.
No. Aquí es un área de descanso aquí en Arizona. Este, pero me voy a poner trucha para ver si hay algún extraterrestre, porque algunos te vienen a descansar así, dicen. Y este, voy a ir al baño. Ahorita cuando fui al baño dejé la puerta abierta de la troca y creo que se me subieron dos. Ahí van adelante. Pero no les digo nada porque se enojan. Este es un extraterrestre.
¿Qué están haciendo?
¿Por qué no lo apuje? ¿Por qué no lo aprietas así?
¿Qué están haciendo?
Ahí va.
Go back here. The In Search of Aliens video altogether probably took me like around 6 months to go from like when I first started working on it to when I felt like I had a finished edit of it, though I did slightly change it after like that that last chunk, just because I kind of, you have thoughts and you go back a little bit. So I spent a lot of time on just this and looking through all the footage. It was also like a really hard time for me when I made this because my grandma had passed away early in that year, 2021, from COVID, because there was no vaccines yet. And she caught it and she was really, I guess, vulnerable. So it was just like, I was like, well, I don't feel like being in art school. And it was like really hard because she was like my closer grandma. Like, I'm named after her. So I kind of just got obsessed with these family footage videos and like seeing more of my family in the past and just really obsessing over them and like wanting to digitize them all and look through them all. And then this storyline really helped me kind of find the lightness again through my dad. But it still felt like such a connection to like my family that I had no idea before, because he never talked about aliens before, like in this life. So it's just, and then we got to talk about it. We got to have all these conversations, and my siblings are in the video too, and how they're talking about like this knowledge, this new knowledge. So it was a very therapeutic work, and I spent a lot of time with it. But I haven't made a video like this since then, because I have changed how I'm making video right now. But I really love this video and like the layering and the playfulness and the editing. Let's see. Okay, so I made this video, and in the background I was working with stained glass and very lightly, but then after I finished the video In Search of Aliens, I felt like, wow, I just finished this work that I've been spending months and months on. I can't go make another video right away, so I kind of took a break from video, and I was just I was showing it and screening it places, which is nice, but I kind of took a break from making anything new with video, and I focused on stained glass for a bit and kind of expanding it into my practice. Before it had been a hobby that I actually picked up a summer break while I was in undergrad. So I learned it over the summer while I was visiting home at a glass workshop here in LA. So it was just for fun. I tried to bring it to Virginia, but there weren't many glass shops there and I didn't have a car. And it was just like, glass is so intense to work with and to get the materials you need. So it just kind of took a break. But then when I came back to LA, there's a great glass shop here where I teach classes now. So I had this work that was kind of me playing with glass and creating an installation with glass and something more immersive in the way that I really love when video is immersive. So this was a piece that came out of chain drawings and different characters holding different kind of figures. So they each had like a thing, like this is like, this was the goddess of war and like violence, and it has a police helicopter and it has the virgin crying. And this one was like the god of tears, and it's just like kind of playing with the moon. It's very just like playing with these symbols. So it was a way for me to bring out my glass into my practice for the first time in this big kind of mural installation in my studio. People really liked it, but it was really hard to work with it at UCLA because they didn't know how to talk about glass. So it was like really weird. I felt very like I was just kind of figuring out what I was doing on my own. So I'm still playing with it now. I feel like I'm still in that space where I'm just kind of installing it and playing with different places in different settings. So
Susan, the scale of this is totally different than I thought it was when I had seen this work just online.
Yeah.
I thought they were, I guess you can't see my hands, but yeah, I thought like each one was maybe like a 12 by 18 or something, but these are huge. This is incredible.
Yeah, this is my studio. So I cleared out my studio and it was like, so the wall in the back is like 13 feet and then the side ones are like 20-ish. So they're a bit longer. Yeah, it's hard to get the scaling. So I need like a person in there. But at the time I wasn't thinking. And I also didn't, when I finished this, I didn't think it was finished. So I was like, it's whatever. And like the faculty, to be honest, were pretty hard on it. Like they think stained glass is too craft and too folk and too traditional and just religious. And it was really hard to get feedback on it. So I was like, okay, well, it's unfinished, but I'll still show it for, we had like an open studios. So I was like, it's okay. It was like really hard.
Wow, that's very interesting to hear about something that would happen at UCLA. Interesting.
Yeah, they're like, they have opinions. And also I'm so like, I take opinions very seriously about my art because I feel like I just want to get better and experiment and play. So after this, I had a really tough time knowing what to do with the glass. I made some works and they were cool, but I need support in a different direction. It was weird. And then I had a show after I graduated from UCLA. I graduated in 2022 and I was like really burnt out after. It was really hard. At the end, it was really tough to go back in person. This was also like the first work that I made there in person since I'd been making video, like at home for so long. And then when we came back, we had our studios again and they were like unused basically since we didn't use them much. So I also wanted to make an installation so that I could use like physical space and make things with my hands and not be on the computer all the time. Because it was making my eyesight get really bad. So I was just like, oh, okay, I'll just like take a break from the computer. Yeah, like I got worse like 1 point. So I used to be like a negative 2.5 and now I'm a negative 3.5 in my eyes. But now it's getting better again. But it was like nice to make something in person and like real or physical. So it was nice to have that space again. But then I graduated right after this work, the next quarter after. and I had a show and in 2023, and it was the first time I publicly, at least, like, showed a work that had both video and stained glass. And it's this work called Stellar Remnants, and it is a video projection work. So you have these star sculptures here that on the top, they have mirrors, so it's reflective, and it can reflect the video off. They have lights inside, and the glass has colors, so you can have different colors, and the video on top gets reflected. So it was kind of fun to have. I had a space where it was like a dark room, and it was pretty small that I could like try to fill it in with this installation, and it was really cool. It was a learning experience, but I was really happy with kind of like bringing two together, and that's something when I have opportunities, I really want to try to do. But it really depends. This one was called Stellar Remnants, and it's about kind of like the passing of my, it was started by this passing of my grandma, because my paternal grandma also passed away, like a few months after my maternal grandma passed away. Jeez. And when,
I'm so sorry.
Yeah, it was hard.
Wow.
It was like, COVID was harsh, but it, when I had that family footage that I had gone through, there was also on the tapes that I digitized footage of funerals, and my grandma's funeral, they were streamed so people could see them online because of COVID. No one wanted to go to the funeral in person, or not. We couldn't go. We couldn't travel either because everyone was scared, because it was before vaccines. So it's like a very scary time. So it's just like it became this thing where like these funerals are being shared publicly, and it's such a private thing, but it also is public, but then everyone's like crying, and it was just like so intense. So I made this work because stellar remnants are the term for the name of a star after they die. They become a stellar remnant, which is like a black hole or a white dwarf or a neutron star. So it kind of is about the transformation of these people. It's like now they've passed, but we're left with these videos of them, also the videos of their funeral. So it's kind of like that's how they live on. Is it the digital, in the digital world or the realm? So that's what this work was really just about, like me kind of processing everything. And it was really beautiful. And then this year I had a show that was part of a duo show with my friend who does ceramics that I met at UCLA. And it was about kind of growing up in the 2000s, in the age of like early internet and computers, to like how it's impacted me today as someone who grew up in that time. I'm not like, I didn't grow up with like the internet totally, but it was like at such an impactful age of like reality TV starting to get really impactful, and like getting online and getting like how it feels to be so public with your profile and yourself. So that's like what this show was about. And it was called Yours Forever. Because I'm also thinking about existence, and now I'm very existential. Ever since like my grandma's died, it's like that's all I think about, is like how we exist after. Because I remember when my grandma died, like my aunts and my mom, they just like rushed to get her phone and get her files and delete her, like she wouldn't text, she would send like audio messages because she did like texting. So she's like all her, you just have her voice saved. And I think of that too, and like you're creating like deepfakes and AI, and how you can recreate people, and how like the forms of you can exist in the future in different digital forms, and you won't know, but it's like you're creating a lot of files for this future, for someone or for somewhere. So I have a hard drive where I save like everything. Like I have everything on there, and I don't, even on my phone, I don't delete photos. I just like save them in albums, and then the rest I just like keep there in case. So that's what this show is kind of about. This work is called Would You Like to Interact? And it's an interactive work where there's a button and people can interact with it. And it's me just standing there waiting for someone to interact with me for a moment. So I'll play it. It doesn't have sound. Yeah, it's all the button does, and it's this glowing button to interact. And otherwise, I have a moment where I'm interacting with someone, kind of like when you like something online, and then you kind of just go back to standby where you don't really exist, or people can't see you on their phone unless you're like doing something. This is just to show kind of like I didn't have a good photo of the setup, but it's just like I had like a black, my black like blanket, just like hooked onto some shelves that I had, and I had a two lights, like one on my side and one in the front, and then I was just filming myself for like 15 minutes, just standing there, just still as possible. I didn't want to move because then it would ruin the video loop, so I just tried to stay as still as possible, which was actually really hard. And then I also had these stickers I made of myself, and it was called Please Take Me Away From Here. And it's these stickers of just me and kind of the idea of like being taken away from the gallery, because I've had really mixed experiences with galleries and the art world, especially in my experience like entering the art world at UCLA. So I'm just like very like, I hate it, but I love it. So I'm just like, please take me away out of this gallery. Just like take me somewhere else. And I'm also existing as a sticker and they're free. So it's just like, people just like, they run out really fast at the opening, and it's just like they end up somewhere and people have my entity and I don't know where they go. I don't know what they put them on, but it's like on this little ghost. I also made them clear, which is not obvious, but the backing is clear. So I'm kind of like semi-transparent when you peel the backing off and stick it somewhere like a ghost. This is just a photo of the second version I did. I was in Hawaii actually when I had to shoot this. So I just did a straight photo as much as possible and just cropping out, since I love to crop out myself out of things and images. And then that's the second kind of version of the photo, which is of these stickers. And I want to make more in different outfits, like little avatars you get to choose. And then I had this video, which was called Susan Sleeping. And it's like I'm sleeping in this TV playing with like screensavers, but it's just like me in this void, just like circling around. For this, I made just different photos where I'm like, I need to get the right angle. So I just tried different things. And I was in this like body skin suit, which I keyed just to make it like kind of different colors, like how the screensavers change color. And I went with this one and cropped it out, just to show some process. It's a very simple process. And then I animated it in After Effects. So pretty simple. I just like love the idea of like just sleeping in that void until the TV's activated. And then in the show, I also like last, I like interacted with the glass and video again. So this one was a phone that I made out of stained glass, an old flip phone that has scrolling through a phone that's kind of empty. Like there's not much on it. It's receiving texts, but it's pretty empty. It has some photos of me in there, but otherwise it's kind of like a dead phone or unused phone. This phone, I made a razor. It's me with video. It has a live camera in there behind the screen, so viewers can interact with it, kind of like a mirror, and it's just like always on, so people had fun with it.
Oh, it's a live camera. That's crazy. I didn't realize.
Yeah, it's a live camera. So it's like a...
Real quick, what's the scale on this piece and the previous piece?
Oh, right. So this one is 43 inches tall and like 15 inches at an angle. So it's kind of big.
Yeah.
And then this one is 36 inches. So it's like 3 feet tall.
Got it.
And then the screen was like, it was like a 10 inch diameter. So it was kind of small, but it like people could like fit. It's a wide angle, so you could see a lot in there.
Yeah. It's still both of them again are like way bigger than I thought. Like I almost thought these were like life size, like a, you know, like the actual size of a phone.
Yeah. I just like wanted them to be interactive and for the screens to actually feel like people could see what's going on. And then the cameras up there were like the camera, like that circle up there. So yeah, the scale, like I changed the scale a lot. So for this one, like the iPods work, they are to scale. So I made a selection of every iPod to like a replica. But these are to scale because I wanted it to be like, you have that experience of like shopping for iPods and seeing the iPods and choosing your own and like picking them out or like finding that same like connection with them as if they were real. So they have also the same quality of the shine because of the glass. And this is like a close up of one of the iPod touches. So it's like that small scale. They're all pretty small, especially the shuffles.
Wait, how are they? I thought they were like embedded in that sheet. Are they attached?
They're magnets. There's magnets on the back.
Wow, that's epic.
Yeah, yeah. So actually, like people can like shop for them. So people could buy them and like pick out. So I kind of wanted to be like I'm selling knockoffs and like kind of like almost like a swap meet. So that was fun because I'm also like thinking about accessibility in the art world and like how I've sold work and it's the prices are crazy and it's just like breaking down an artwork into like 100 or 200 and then each one is like it's, you know, expensive but it's like much less than like for fine artwork. So that was kind of playing with that idea. And that's it.
Nice. That's perfect timing.
Cool. Let me get out of here.
Well, I have a bunch of questions, but does anyone else have any questions for Susan? You can ask about UCLA. I like that we were kind of dishing some tea on UCLA. That was nice.
yeah.
Or you could ask about like living and working in Los Angeles. I don't know if any of you have the desire to move to sunny California. Oh, wait, did we get a text question? Oh,
yeah. So it says, did you know that you would work with the medium you did today? I don't know. I feel like I really, really love digital art. And that's why when I did start in art, it was like I went as fast as I could just straight to new media. Cause that's where it felt like really comfortable. And I was already doing like computer science. So it felt like nice to still be on the computer and make art, like have a different purpose and play with different technologies. So I feel really like that's where my comfort zone is, especially cause I can't draw. Like I really can't. So it's like, I don't have options to go that way. Cause I'm like really bad at it. But the glass has given me a way to do stuff the material wise and not video, but all the glasswork I make in Illustrator first. So it's like I make everything. I'm still not drawing. I'm just like doing everything in Illustrator.
Nice.
Yeah.
Maddie, do you have a question?
Yeah. Oh my god! And then I just lost it. I wanted to ask about. Oh, when you're using old memories, because I do something similar where I try and take old photos and incorporate that into some mixed media type canvas work. But I find myself almost wanting to try and predict or portray a certain emotion from my audience. Do you also feel that when you're creating work with your memories?
When I'm making interactive work, I think about more technically like how the viewers are going to interact with it and how that'll be like a part of how things are laid out, like the scale of things, like with the phones being bigger so that the viewers can actually like see themselves or they can like see the scale of the screen a lot better, or see the video projections and be immersed in them. So I think like I try to get close to that immersion or being part of the work in order for them to respond to it. And then emotionally, I feel like I don't know how they're going to respond. I feel like a lot of my work is very selfish, and I think art is kind of selfish for me, and that it's just like me processing through different emotions and grieving. And if the audience likes it, then it's like they connect to it in some way, like they connect to the personal because they see something of themselves in it. And if they don't see themselves in it, then they're not my audience. And I feel like they have a different audience. I think that's what I learned in grad school too. It's just like you can't have everyone as your audience. Like that's just like that's something else, and that's like not for me. I feel like I kind of learned like the people who come to my shows and support my work and follow me are like we're on the same page.
Thank you for your answer. That was a lovely way of putting it.
Yeah, that was a pretty badass way of putting it. Like, look, if this doesn't work for you, then it's not for you. That's amazing. I
I feel like it's true,
haven't
though.
really given myself that kind of grace or freedom, actually. I've like maybe I take on too much responsibility, and that feels actually very liberating.
Yeah. I just think because I'm also like so existential, I'm like, I'm gonna like die possibly really soon. And I just want to make what I make. I don't think I will, but I could. It's like things just like I think because for me, like COVID was so intense and like things, COVID just happened out of nowhere in LA. Like it became really serious. And then it's like, oh, like this is real. This is happening. And everything's changed like in a week. It's like, oh, that could happen anytime. And this is all made up. And we can just choose what we do. And I think also with the elections, and it's like people were just choosing what we do. It's like these systems, like the facade kind of falls away. And it's like I'm choosing to be an artist and to spend my time making these things. So I feel like I really have to like what I'm making. And I had a tough time out of grad school feeling like I liked what I was making in that last bit of time there, and to be away from it and to have time reflecting. Now I just do whatever I want and just try to survive with money and worry about that stuff. But it's like a separate thing now.
That's incredible. Shauna, I see a hand on your little square.
So what made you want to incorporate stained glass into your work?
I had it like I've been doing it for years by the time I like put it into my practice. And I started doing it as a way to make, I don't know, beautiful things. And I had trouble because I can't draw and I don't paint that well. So it's like hard for me to make beautiful things with my hands. But then the glass as a material is so beautiful. And I just like really loved it. So when I brought it in, the first thing I made was actually like the glass diamond face tears. And it was like a way to like reflect kind of like my sadness. And that was coming out of COVID, but make it beautiful. Because it's like these tears that are, they have this emotion behind them, but they are shiny and they're diamonds and they're gems. And I could make luxury products for the first time, like these fine art products with my hands and produce something. And so I really liked that element of it conceptually too. Because video, like I really love video, but it's this other world and conversations that I was having with my glass. So I was, then I had to figure out how to work with glass and how to what it means for my practice. But when I started, I just loved making like beautiful things and how that feels when you're also someone who grew up poor and not owning beautiful things. And like now I can make things and decorate my apartment with beautiful things because I can make them. And that feels like that's nice to have that at least from my own hands if I can't like buy it.
Anyone else questions? I mean, I got a ton, but I don't want to hog all the time. I'll slip a fast one in. Have you seen your sticker in the wild anywhere?
I have. I saw it like so one of Peter's friends came, and they are at here nearby is a school, is Caltech, and I saw it in like a room because we were like walking, and I saw it like against like a corner of like a room, like on the
Whoa.
wall.
Do you have any idea like how it would have gotten there? Like, oh, that's probably this person who took it, or you just have no idea how it got there?
It was probably one of his, because his friends did come to the opening, so it's probably one of them that put it there. But I didn't know they took it, so it's kind of cool too. So I know it wasn't Peter, so like a
Yeah.
someone also like came up to me, and they were just like, I just like had bumped into them, and then they looked at me, and they recognized me, and I was like, oh, is this you? And then they turn around, and they have their bag, and they have the sticker on their bag. And I was like, oh yeah, that's
Whoa.
me.
Famous.
But it's just like this weird recognition.
Yeah.
Got to know them.
Yeah, that's really epic. If you all have another question, just jump in or do like the hand raising thing. I actually don't know how to do that, so just jump in and talk over me. I maybe real quick, I had since this is new information for me, your math and computer science background, like totally blown away. I had no idea. Do you feel that aside from just using the computer as a tool in your process, do you feel that worming its way into your work at all? And I guess it's part of you, so it can't not, but how do you see that functioning in your work these days?
I feel like it's more like the way I think about things. Also my personality. Like I feel like I get along better with like at UVA, like most of my friends were like in physics and like engineering. And so it was just like I had that personality, like being very nerdy, and like I've always been very nerdy in school. And so I feel like that, and like I'm very methodical and like trying to, and very problem solving, especially with like the electronics and like just trying to figure out all the technical stuff. And I also try to be very like clean and precise. But I don't know if that says about the personality of people who study like math or like science, but definitely like on a personal level, I like most of my friends like come from those backgrounds. And I have friends that I've made in the art world, but they're definitely like very hippie-ish, and especially like in LA. It's like very hippie-ish, and I'm like, oh my God, I'm like, I feel like so different. So that's a personal level. In my art, I think I'm just very methodical.
That's awesome. Cool. I mean, again, I have more. I just don't want to take time if anyone else has a question for Susan while we're here. We're almost done. We'll let you go in a couple minutes. Cool. I work or I
Oh,
have
there's one
been.
in the chat.
Oh, sorry, there's one in chat. Sorry. Oh, nice. Sick question, Alexis. Very
Yeah.
good.
Ruin the feelings in making it. I think it can be limiting. And I actually, so like when the main works that I have sold the most is like my tears pieces, which I actually feel like it fits the theme of like them being sold. And like it's very like, at least for me, because it's like who buys tears? Like who buys someone's tears as like this beautiful thing? So it's somewhat, I don't know what it's called, the word, but it's like I'm making something out of like this sadness, and then someone's buying it because it's like they want to hang it on their wall. And that feels like weird to me. But that's like what I've sold the most of, and like what I've had the most like financial success in. And I was in an art fair in December 2023, and I worked with a gallery, and they just like told me like make these things that always sell really well. And it's just like I haven't I not working with them anymore, because it's like really weird to like put so much pressure on me to only show certain things. And then they wanted to do a show after, but I didn't like working with them because it's like that's only about the things I'm selling. Because at the time when I was selling the tears, I had made them for like a genuine reason. But then when I did the art fair, it was like my first one. It was just like, this is so weird. So I don't know about that life, and I feel like I'm also like in the next year I'm doing shows that are outside of like commercial galleries because I think I'm really excited for making work that is just about the conceptual and the art and not so much about the selling. With the iPods, it was kind of about selling art because I'm like selling bits of this iPod installation that are more accessible. Like they range from like $40 to 200 based on which iPod it was. So it's like more accessible than like if you bought the whole thing, it would be like $10,000. So it's just like that was playing with the idea of selling art, along with selling iPods. So I don't know if it, I don't know if everyone's making it, but I feel like it ruins like maybe like what I want to go on making. So next year I'm not worried about that. I started teaching and that has like helped me a lot financially. So now the art I make is just like for the art. And if I sell stuff, then it's cool. But it's also I've been applying to grants. I got grants and that kind of thing. I've been doing a lot more. But when I was like at UCLA, they're like so commercial. So they're just like really pushing me into that world and connecting me with galleries, which is really nice. And I've really gotten to know a lot of people in LA, which is great. But it's like I'm trying to see what I like better. I'm not sure.
Excellent question. These are all been excellent questions. Thanks, everyone. That's it. That's time. Unless anyone has a burning question you want to ask Susan, do it now. Cool. Thank you, everyone, for joining us live. It's so good to see you. So glad you could join live and chat with Susan. Susan, thank you so much for this. And I'll send you a file of the recording when it is posted.
Yeah, thanks for having me, and thanks you guys for coming.
Yeah, have a great evening, everyone. I will talk. Oh, wait, and we have the next visiting artist. Oh, shoot, I pulled it up on my phone. It's in the visiting artist module, but the next one is November 11th, Monday, November 11th, again at 6 p.m. And you can see that info in the visiting artist module. Cool. All right, everyone, I will talk to you all later. Susan, again, thank you. That was incredible. I learned something new. All
Yeah.
right.
Thank
I'll
you,
talk to you
Dana.
later. Yep. Take care, everyone.